looking at is a tutorial, a Jupyter notebook, and we'll cover what that means. Now we need to be able to run the code. So I am going to run the code. So while that starts, when we click run, we take the same code and explanations and everything and then open it up on an online platform which allows us to execute this code. While that starts, on the lesson page, you will find a link to a discussion forum. So you can just click this link and that will open up the discussion forum. And this is the place where you can ask questions. So that's how you ask questions. Moving along, I click the run button and that opened up an interface like this. What you're looking at right now is called the Jupyter interface. So a place where you can write some code, a place where you can execute some code. Jupyter is an IDE or integrated development environment and it runs completely on your browser. That's the great thing about it. Because if I zoom out here for a bit, I am looking at this Jupyter notebook running on my browser, but the actual execution of all the code will happen somewhere on this server called hub.mybinder.org. So right now what I'm looking at is the files associated with my project. And the file that you want to open up is called First Steps with Python. Just click the First Steps with Python file and that will open up for you to see. So the first thing that I'm going to do is to click on the kernel menu and click Restart and Clear Output. What this will do is I've written some code and I've executed it and there are a lot of outputs of the code. I just want to remove them so that we can execute the code from scratch. I will also just hide the header so that we have a little more space to see things. Now we're ready to go. This is our first step with Python and Jupyter. This will be like a quick Python tutorial, but we will pick up all the important topics that we need to start doing data analysis. While I go through this material, I will leave out some of the things as exercises for you to try out. But you know, there's a lot of detail. There's a lot of explanation here. There's an explanation on how to run the code. So we are running it online. So we use the run button, but you can also run it on your computer locally. And there are some instructions here. The setup is a little bit advanced, so I would recommend skipping it if you are just getting started. Now coming to Jupyter notebooks themselves, this document that we are looking at, it is made up of cells. It is like a stream of cells. So you have cell after cell and cells can contain explanations. So here I have written some explanation in a cell or cell can contain some code or some programs written in Python. Now cells can be executed and their outputs can be viewed right within the notebook, which makes it a really powerful platform for experimentation. You just type something and you run that code and see its output, then you change it and try it again, and then you add some explanation using a text cell. So it's great, and we really love Jupyter notebooks. That's why we've built so many things around it. So the first thing that we will do is to start using Python as a calculator. That's the simplest way to use it. And what you can do is you can simply write and execute Python code by adding a code cell within Jupyter. So how do you add a code cell? There are a couple of ways to do it. By the way, this what you're looking at here is a code cell, but I'll show you how to create a code cell. So you can click on a cell. So select a particular cell and this one is a text cell. So then you go insert and insert cell below. So when you do insert cell below, that automatically adds a code cell for you. You can also change the type of this cell. You can change from code to markdown. So markdown is text basically. And then you can type some text. And then what we are going to do is we are going to start running some code cells. So I already have a code cell here. I'm not going to add more. And here are some simple arithmetic expressions that I've written out, 2 plus 3 plus 9. And now to execute this code, what I need to do is to click the run button. So there's a run button here that you can click. You can also click cell, run cells. Or there's a nice keyboard shortcut here, which is shift plus enter. And that will execute and give you the output. So that's great. Now we are able to add numbers with Python. Here's a subtraction. Here is a multiplication. For multiplication, we use the star sign. Here is a division, 100 divided by 7. Python automatically converts that into a decimal number, even though these are integers. And you can see that it's about 14.28. Now, if you just want to get the quotient without the decimal part of it, just get an integer, then you use a double division sign here, 100 by 7. And if you want to see the remainder, then you use this percentage or ampersand operator. This gives you the remainder. So the remainder is 2 and the quotient is 14. And we can verify that. We can just take the remainder 2 and we can add it to 14 times 7. and we get 100. So you can combine them as well. Another operator that you might want to learn about is the exponential operator. So this simply does 5 to the power of 3. You can derive 5 to the power of 5 and so on. So as you might expect, this is really simple to get started. You write a code cell, you put some code into a code cell, and then you execute it and it works. And that is valid Python code. So that's great. And as you might expect, these operators have certain precedence by default, but you can also combine them and you can specify the order in which they need to be evaluated by specifying brackets. For instance, here I've put 2 plus 5 in a bracket, so that gets executed first, then this, and then these two get multiplied, then that gets divided by 4 to the power of 3. And that's the output. So that's basic arithmetic with Python. These are the operators that are supported: addition, subtraction, multiplication, division, and exponent. And what you can do as an exercise, if you're new to Python, if you're new to programming, is just open up some word problems. I've given a link to some simple word problems and try to solve them by adding some formulas here and just getting the outputs. So let's now solve a multi-step problem. So here we have a grocery store that sells a bag of ice for $1.25 and makes a 20% profit on each bag. If it sells 500 bags of ice, how much total profit does it make? Okay, a simple arithmetic problem. You may have seen this in school, probably primary school. So how we go about it is we lay out all the information. So the cost of ice bag is 1.25. The profit margin is 20%. That is 20 by 100, 0.2. So the profit per bag is the profit margin times the cost of the ice bag. So then we have this expression. And then the number of bags is 500. And then the total profit then is number of bags times the profit per bag. So finally, we end up with this expression. This is the point where you would pick up a calculator. And here we are going to use Python to do it. So the grocery store makes a profit of $125 total. Now, this is an okay way to use it, but this is not using the full power of Python. And it's not clear by looking at the code what these numbers represent. So what we can do is we can actually give names to each of these numbers by creating variables. And variables are an interesting concept in a programming language where you can take information and put them into these boxes or containers and then give them a name. These boxes are called variables, and the information stored in them is called the variable's value. So here we are now going to create three variables. So the cost of ice bag is the first variable. It has the value $1.25. Then we have the profit margin, another variable. It has the value 0.2. And finally, we have the number of bags. This is 500. Now, one thing to keep in mind is that I have used underscores because variables need to be a single word, and you can break out words using underscores in Python. If you do not have this, then you will get an error. So now we have the cost of ice bag. That's great. We have the profit margin. We have the number of bags. Now, in the arithmetic operations, we can start using these. By the way, this is called declaring a variable. So you put a variable name, and then you put an equal to sign, and then you put the value. So now the variable has that value. To check that value, you just type the name of the variable out, and then you can see the value. Now, we have the profit per bag. Now, this is a new variable I'm creating. And to create this variable, I'm actually going to use an expression that depends on other variables. And this is a nice thing where you can start combining these things together and collect a lot of information. So now you have the cost of ice bag. So that's 1.25 times the profit margin. So that becomes our profit per bag. Then we have the total profit. So the total profit is the number of bags times the profit per bag. And now we can check the total profit. It is 125. So already this is much nicer, where you go through these few lines and you understand what's really happening here. And the other good thing is, now if you change the number of bags, like if you have on a different day, you have a different number of bags, you can simply reuse the values of these variables. You do not have to note them down somewhere else. That's a great thing about programming. One minor thing here, a variable has to first be defined using this assignment operation. If it is not defined yet, for instance, I have not defined a variable called net profit, and you try to access it, then you will get an error. And now don't worry if you get an error in Python, in Jupyter, because normally a lot of programming languages, when you get an error, you have to stop. But in Jupyter, you do not need to stop. You can actually just go ahead and change something. Let's say the net profit, I just want to assign it a value of 100, and run it again, and everything will work fine. So that's a great way to just fix things, try out different ideas, break things, and then the more you break, the more you learn. So this is good. Now we are able to display the total profit, $125. But it would be nice to show this as a message. And that's what we can do using the print function. Now, what's a function? Now, a function is a reusable set of instructions. Just as we are writing some code, we are writing some programs here. A lot of programs have already been written for the common things that you might want to do. And Python provides a lot of built-in functions. The print function is what we're going to see. And it also allows us to define our own functions. So here now we have the print function. And the way to use a function is to type the name of the function, then open a bracket, and then give it some inputs. So here we are giving it a first input. This is some text in English that we want it to print. One important thing to note here is that when we are giving it some text in English, anywhere in Python, we need to use quotations. Because otherwise Python tries to interpret this as code. But obviously there is nothing inbuilt in Python called glossary. So this will give you an error. And that is why we have quotations around anything written in English. That's the first input to print. So we're saying that print this, and then we give it a comma, and then we also print the value inside the total profit variable. All right. And that's the print function. So now that prints out, the grocery store makes a total profit of $125. So great. We made good progress already. We've started using variables. We've started using the print function. Now, one thing that you can do here, because all of these code cells so far, we've just been writing a single line. It can get a little bit tedious and also a little bit confusing when you have all these different code cells. So Jupyter allows you to write multiple lines of code within a code cell. So what you can do is you can rewrite the solution to the problem that we saw above. And we can use just a single code cell here. So here we are saying that the cost of the ice pack is 1.25, the profit margin is 0.2, and then we are performing the calculation, and then we are displaying the result. And if I run this, you will see that it prints the exact same result. Now, one interesting thing here to note is that I've actually written some words in English, and I said use quotations, but I've not used quotations. That's because this is a comment. So here, what happens is the moment you enter the pound or the hash character, and then maybe give a space after it. So when you enter the hash character inside a code cell, that becomes a comment. That is where you can write something that will be ignored by the Python interpreter. So Python will not evaluate it, but this is information that you want to share with somebody who is going to read the code. For instance, I have shared this notebook with you, and you can now understand by reading this comment what this block of code does. Similarly, blank lines are ignored, and then this comment is ignored as well. This is called documentation. Comments are a great way to just document what you are doing. And there are a couple of ways to define comments. So comments can live at the end of a code statement. Comment can have its own line, or comments can also span multiple lines. And you can try these out. This is an exercise for you to try out. I will not go over it in a lot of detail. The next thing that I want to cover is evaluating conditions in Python. So here I have a few variables, and if I want to check that it has a certain value or not. Let's say I want to check if my favorite number is actually equal to 1. Then Python has the equal to operator. This is called the equality check. So here you give it something on the left and then something on the right. And it compares the two and returns true, the value true, if they are equal. On the other hand, if the two values are not equal, for instance, my favorite number and my least favorite number are not equal, it returns false. Okay, so there's the equal to operator. And then there are a few of these. So there is the not equal to operator. So this is read as not equals. Then there is the greater than operator. And then there is less than operator. For instance, here is the less than operator. My favorite number less than 10. That's true. And my least favorite number, which is 3, less than my favorite number, which is 1. That is false. Okay. Then we also have a greater than equal to operator and a less than equal to operator. The key thing to note is that they return true or false, which are special keywords in Python. So that's operators. And just like arithmetic operations, the result of a comparison operation can also be stored in a variable. So for instance, here I have the cost of the ice bag is 1.25. And if I check if the cost of the ice bag is greater than 10, I can put that result into is ice bag expensive. And then I can simply print out that result. So you can see that the ice bag is actually not expensive since the value is false. Conditions can be combined. there are three ways, three logical operations to combine conditions. One is the AND operation. So A and B holds true only if both A and B are true. Otherwise, it's false. Then we have the OR operation. The OR operation A or B holds true if either one or both of A or B are true. And finally, you have the NOT operation. So NOT simply takes a condition and then reverses the condition. For instance, my neutral number has the value 3. So this condition is true. And then when you say NOT, so NOT true becomes false. So you can play around with this. And what I would suggest, the way you try this out, is to just go to File and then go to New Notebook, open up a new Python 3 notebook. Now take that and put that into one half of your screen. And then take the existing notebook and put that into the other half of the screen. And especially if you're new to Python, if you're new to Jupyter, what you should be doing is you should be looking at the code and typing it out yourself. And this is a great way to learn for beginners. Just type out everything. Do not just do a shift enter so that you just run through everything in 20 minutes and you're done. Now take the time to type things out. Take the time to try out experiments. Now you can break things. What happens if you do this? And I've not defined this. This is really the best way to just experience what it is like to write this code. This is how I recommend working on all the notebooks. Start with a blank notebook and just type out the code line by line. All right. So one last thing that I want to cover is that so far I've been typing some code into these code cells and then I've been writing some text here. You can actually edit this text as well. Maybe you need to add some more explanation for yourself. Maybe you want to take notes. So to edit this text, just double click on the text and then you can start up editing it. For instance, I just do this as an edit and then I do shift enter again and that changes this text. One of the nice things about the way text is written in Jupyter is that it uses a formatting style called Markdown. So you can see here, this text actually is a header. And then below here, I have a bunch of different headers and then I have a bulleted list and I have a numbered list. So there's a lot of interesting stuff going on here. And it's really easy to create this style like this. Just to organize your notebooks a little better, you can use Markdown. And how do you use that? If I just double click, you can see that all I need to do to make my text bigger is to add a couple of pound characters and a space in a Markdown cell. And that will make my text big. So if you had 1 pound character, that'll make a header, and then you can try different sizes of headers with different pound characters. To create a bulleted list, all you need to do is leave a space, line space, and then use the star character, and then just write the items that will get converted into a bullet. You can also create a numbered list. You can also create links. This is a way to create a link. You can also include images. This is a way to include an image. And in fact, you can include code examples as well. Now, these code examples that are inside the Markdown cells will not be executed. They cannot be executed. So it's more for an explanation or documentation purpose. Let me just run that and show you. So here's an image and here's the code. So Markdown is very simple. It takes 20 minutes to learn it. And it's a really nice way to write pretty text. So you can learn the full syntax of Markdown. Here I've linked to a tutorial. So that brings us pretty much to the end of our first Jupyter notebook. So we've learned some Python here, basic arithmetic, logic, conditions. We've learned a little bit about the Jupyter interface. Now, as I said, this notebook is running online on a free service. It's just a website that lets you run Jupyter notebooks online for free. But since it's a free service, it's going to shut down after some time. So your notebooks, if you leave the tab, if you go away from it for 10 minutes or something, then this notebook will shut down. So what you can do is, whether you're running this notebook online or on your local machine, you can save your work from time to your jovian.ml account. So the same account that you used for logging in. All you need to do is run pip install jovian. This is a command that will install a Jovian Python module, a Python library. It is what we will need to actually send our notebook, this notebook, to your Jovian account. Then we do import Jovian. Well, that actually imports the library and tells Python that we are now ready to use the library. And finally, there is a function called jovian.commit. So just as the print function, we've written a commit function that will take your notebook and that will put it on your Jovian account so that you don't need to do any other steps. So you just say jovian.commit and then you give it a project name. So you just type project equals. And here I'm just going to say first steps with Python demo. So now we have jovian.commit and project. And when you run this, it will ask you for an API key. So to get the API key, just go to jovian.ml. If you're not logged in, if you're on the website, you can just click sign up or sign in and sign in with Google or GitHub. But once you're logged in, you will see your profile, and on your profile, you will see an API key. So you can copy this API key. Just click the button and it will get copied to your clipboard. And then let's come back here and let us just enter the API key. So it'll just show you a bunch of stars. It is hidden. I do not want you to see my API key. But once you press enter, this is then going to take this notebook and then put it online. Now I can just open up this link, the final link that it gives me, and I can shut this down. So there you go, right? Now I'm leaving this site and I'm shutting this down. And now I end up with this page, similar to the page that we started out with. We have the same Jupyter notebook here, and you can actually take this link and then share it online with other people, just as I did with you. And you can see that the notebook is here. You have all of these options. If you want to continue running, you can click run on binder and continue running. So this is how we use Jovian. And you will be using Jovian to actually work on the assignments and things like that. So that's a quick intro for you. Okay, so we've covered our first steps with Python. Now we're ready to move on to variables and data types. So just click the variables and data types link. Now this is yet another Jupyter notebook. Once again, click the run button, go to run and click run on binder. Okay, so now we are once again back on Jupyter. Once again, this is running online somewhere, and we can now open up the second notebook, Python variables and data types. Let's just give it a moment to load. There it is. And the first thing you need to do once again is go to kernel, restart and clear output. Okay, you need to do this only if you want to clear out all the outputs that are already calculated. So I just want to restart and clear all the outputs out. And let me just hide the toolbar so that you can see it better. Okay, so variables. And we know already what variables are. They are containers for storing information, for storing data. And the data stored in a variable is called a value. And this is how you create and access the value of a variable. So you set my favorite color and then you access my favorite color. And a variable is created using this assignment statement that we have already seen. And note that this assignment statement is actually different from the equality comparison operator, which is the equal to operator, which operates on two things on the left and right and returns to you a value true or false. So this is a common mistake that we often do when we are starting out with programming, unfortunately. You can also define multiple variables on a single line like this, comma separated. So there you see they have the three values. And you can assign the same value to multiple variables by chaining an assignment operation. So for instance, if I write color 6 equals magenta, then I can say color 5 equals that, and then I can say color 4 equals that. So that chains these operations and each of them gets the same value. So that's how you create variables. Now in Python, you can change the value stored in a variable simply by assigning a new value to it. Now if I redefine or reassign the value red to my favorite color, you can see that the value blue has gone away. The value blue is lost and no longer accessible. And now the value has become red. So this is important that when you reassign a variable, the old value is lost, gone. So be careful. What you can also do is that while reassigning a new value, you can use the old value of the variable as an input to the expression which is used to assign the value. For instance, counter equals 10. And then we are saying counter equals counter plus 1. Now, normally in math, you would cancel these out and this would end up with 0 equals 1. This is not what we can do here because this is assignment. So counter plus 1 becomes 10 plus 1 and that gets put into counter. So counter has the value 11, right? And since this is such a common pattern, whenever you're doing variable equals variable, then operator something, you can also write it like this. So counter equals 10 and now we do counter plus equals 4. That's the same as counter equals counter plus 4. So this is how you create variables. Now a quick note on naming variables. Variable names can be short, like a single character A, X, Y, or they can be long, like my favorite color, profit margin, the three musketeers. But there are a few rules you have to follow while naming Python variables. A variable's name has to start with a letter or the underscore character. It cannot start with a number. A variable name can only contain lowercase and uppercase letters. So A to Z, lowercase or uppercase. it can contain digits except at the first position, and it can contain underscore characters. And then finally, variable names are case sensitive. So a variable with all lowercase is different from a variable with A and V in uppercase, and that is different from a variable. So these are all different variables with different values. Just be aware of that while creating variables. So here are some valid legal variable names. And below what you can see here, these are some invalid variables that I've created. So here we have a space that causes a problem. Here we have a special character that causes a problem. Here we have the hyphen. Python actually reads this as a minus. It tries to subtract these three variables, but they don't exist, and that's why there's an issue. And finally, here we're trying to use a number as the starting. You cannot start a variable with a number. So that's all we wanted to talk about variables. It's a very simple concept. Python makes it really easy to use them. And at this point, what we'll do from now on is, after every section, just record our work. So I'm just installing the Jovian library, and I'm running jovian.commit. So that's committed now. Any data that you store inside a Python variable has a type. So far we've been working mainly with numbers, but there is a lot of different types of data that you can store within a Python variable. And a variable's type can be checked using the type function. For instance, a variable has the value 23, and its type, if you use the type function, its type is int. Int stands for integer. Similarly, is today Saturday? It's false. Its type is bool. It stands for boolean. My favorite car is some text, and its type is str, which stands for string. And finally, the Three Musketeers, it looked like it was like a list of three strings, so it has the type list. And Python has several built-in data types for storing different types of information into variables. What we will look at are some of the most commonly used data types. Now, there are a few primitive data types: integers, floats, booleans, none, and string. And then you have these other types like list, tuple, dictionary, and then you have sets and classes and so on. These are called data structures or containers because they hold multiple pieces of data together. And each piece of data then has its own type. That's a key distinction. So let's start by looking at integers then. We've been working with them. We know what they are. They represent positive or negative whole numbers. So from negative infinity to infinity. Only thing to note is that they should not include any decimal points. So here's an integer, and it has the type int, as we've already seen. Now, unlike other programming languages like C++ and Java, where you may have different types of integers, there is no such limitations on what is the lowest or highest value an integer can hold. In Python, all integers are arbitrarily large, right? So here you see a large negative number. It is quite arbitrarily large, and it still has the type int, and that's integers, pretty straightforward. Then we have floats or floating point numbers. So these are basically numbers with a decimal point. Again, there is no limit on the value of the float. Although what will happen is some kind of approximation might happen depending on how many decimals you put in. So they are a little bit limited compared to integers for sure. So here I'm looking at the value of pi, the mathematical constant. I put in 3.14 and so on. And then I can check its value. And you can see here that it actually truncated the value around 15 or 20 decimals. So there is a limitation in floats there. And then if you check the type of pi, that turns out to be a float. And one important distinction here that we often tend to miss is that even a whole number is treated as a float if it is written with a decimal point. For instance, here we have a number which I've written as 3.0. That's a float because there's a decimal there. And similarly, even if I do not have something after the decimal, even if there's just a decimal, that is also treated as a float. So just know that sometimes that trips people up a little bit. And then there's another way to write floating point numbers. Let's say you have a very small number with 0.5 zeros and then a 1. The way you can write that, let's say if you want to do 0.00001, you do 1e minus 5. So that e minus 5 basically gets converted to 10 raised to the power minus 5, and that gets multiplied with this number. But I'll just do 1e minus 2. And you can see it has the value 0.01. Here's another one. Here I'm using a positive exponent. So here this is the Avogadro number. So here 6.022 times 10 to the power 23. And there you go. So that is the Avogadro number. That's pretty much it about floats. Again, pretty straightforward. And floats can be converted to integers and vice versa. So the way to do it is using the float and int functions. So the types that we see, these are actually functions that you can use. So the float function, if you pass it an integer, let's say float current year, or it had the value 2020. So now that becomes 2020.0. Or float times a large negative number. Let's see what that value is. So what I'm doing here is I am actually going to insert a code cell. The way I could do it is say insert and insert cell below, or I can simply just press escape plus B and that will insert a code cell. Okay. So let's just type the name of a variable. And again, what you saw here was that I simply typed A underscore L and then I pressed the tab character, the tab key, and that automatically completes to a variable name. So that's one nice thing about Jupyter. So you see here, it's a large negative number. We can convert it into a float. So when you convert it into a float, some precision is lost, but now you can see that it's written in scientific notation. Similarly, we can convert the value pi to integer. So pi was 3.14. When you convert a float into an integer, the part after the decimal gets removed. So even if you're at 1.99 and you convert it to int, that gives you back 1. So that can be a little unexpected sometimes. And finally here, we are taking the Avogadro number and converting it into integer. When we perform arithmetic operations, what happens is if all the operations are integers, generally speaking, the result is also an integer. But if any of the numbers that you're operating upon is a float, then the result gets converted into a float. So for instance, 45 times 3.0 is a float, but 45 times 3 is an int. Now, one exception is the division operator. The division operator always returns a float because there's no way to know in advance whether there is going to be a decimal point or not. So just to be consistent, it always returns a float, whether it's 3.33 or whether it's 5.0. And if you want to get back an integer, you simply use the double division. This is also called the integer division operator, and that returns an integer. Okay, so that's floats, pretty straightforward. Then we have Booleans. We've already seen these. Booleans are the results of conditions. Essentially, the Boolean type has exactly two values, true and false. There's no other value there. Floats, there are unlimited. Integers, there are unlimited. But Booleans are just these. And Booleans have the type bool. So here I'm setting is today Sunday to true. Then I just check the type. This should say is today Sunday. Yeah. Just check the type of is today Sunday, and that turns out to be a bool. That's how you declare a Boolean. It could also have been a condition. So let's say this could have been 2 less than 3, and it is still true. Let me revert that. And Booleans are generally returned as a result of a comparison operator. So for instance, here I have the cost of an ice bag is 1.25, and I have the comparison whether it's greater than 10. So now the result, the variable, is ice bag expensive, is holding a Boolean value. You can check that with the type. An interesting thing is that Booleans are automatically converted to integers when they are used in arithmetic operations. True gets converted to 1 and false gets converted to 0. So it's useful that if you have a bunch of Booleans and then you want to just add them together to just see how many trues there are, how many falses there are, you can simply add them as integers. So if I do 5 plus false, 5 gets converted into the integer 0. So we end up with 5. And if I do 3 plus true, and here I'm doing 3 dot. So first true gets converted to the integer 1. Then since you're adding an integer and a float, that gets converted into a float. And you end up with a float 4.0. So that's something to keep in mind. Another very useful thing is that any value in Python can be converted to a Boolean using the bool function. So you just use the bool function, put in anything that you write in Python, any value or any expression, technically speaking, that expression will get converted into a Boolean. Now, when it gets converted into a Boolean, how does Python decide whether it should be a true or a false? There is only a limited number of things that become false. So the value false itself is false. And then all the empty states of the different data types, they get converted to false as well. So you have the integer 0. That gets converted to false. You have the float 0.0 is false. Then the empty value none, we will see it. That gets converted to false. The empty text, the empty list, the empty tuple, empty dictionary, empty set in range. So all of these get converted to false automatically. And we will see how this is useful later when we learn about if statements. These are some examples of false. And then here, these are other examples of values that are converted to true. So these are called, the values that become false are often called falsy values, and the values that become true are often called truthy values. So it's also called falsy nothingness of those values. So that's Booleans. Next we have the none type. The none type has a single value called none, and it is used to indicate the absence of a value, right? If you want to declare a variable, let's say, which may be assigned some value later on, or because of some reason you want to indicate that a value is missing, but you still have to, let's say, set a variable, then you can simply set it to none. This is nice to have that type so that you don't have to use zero as a fill-in or use false as a fill-in, which you have to do in other languages. So you just say variable name equals none, and that sets it to none, and it has the type. Nothing much going on there. Finally, the last primitive data type is a string. So a string is used to represent text in Python. Why is it called string? You can think of it like a string of characters tied together with a string, a sequence of characters. And strings in Python must be surrounded using quotations. And you can use either the single quote or the double quote. And strings have the type string, S-T-R-I-N-G. So here, let's create a string today. And it has the type str. Oops, I guess this is an error. This should just say str. You can use either single quotes or double quotes to create a string. What might happen is that the text that you want to write itself may have single or double quotes, so just be careful about that. Now, if you're creating a string with a single quote and there is a single quote inside, for instance, one flew over the cuckoo's nest. Now, what happens here is the string ends here, and then Python starts to execute this as proper Python code, and then it's going to show you an error. Okay, it says invalid syntax. So this is where what you might want to do, one technique is to just add a slash. This is the other slash that is above your enter or return key. So just add a slash. What it does is this escapes the next character so that it is not treated as a closing quotation mark. Okay. And the slash won't show up when you actually print it. That is one way to check it. So you can see here it says one flew over the cuckoo's nest. So we have escaped the quote. The other way is to simply use double quotations when you have single quotations in your string, and single quotations when you have double quotations in your string. And there are some more examples here. I will let you play with these. Now, you may have a lot of questions. What happens if I have both double and single quotes? What happens if I have to break my string into multiple lines? I can't fit it on a line. All these things, Jupyter is a great way to try them out. The way you should try it is first try something. Try what you think might be the solution and run it and then get an error. And then maybe look up online. Or maybe just take the error and Google it, or maybe just post that error on the forum and then somebody answers it, and then you will learn how to actually do it. And once you do that, you will retain it better. So there are some examples of different types of strings. You can also create strings that span multiple lines. So for instance, here, this is a string that goes over 4 or 5 lines. The way to do that is to use 3 quotations. 3 quotations is a special marker in Python. That's our multi-line string, and you can experiment with these parts. I'm going to leave it up to you. But what's interesting is now already with string, even though it's a primary data type, it actually does contain a bunch of characters. So it's a container as well. You can actually check the length of a string using the len function. You can check how many characters it contains. For instance, length of my favorite movie, One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest, is 31. And then there are some special characters. So for instance, the slash n character represents a new line. And then there are escaped characters. So these special characters or escaped characters are actually counted as a single character. So for instance, here I have a multi-line string where I start the string, then I have A, and then I have a enter. So now this enter is actually a character in Python, because Python stores the enter or the new line as a character. This is the slash n character. Then we have B. So in total, there are 3 characters here. And you can see that sometimes it gets printed like this. So we have A, and then we have slash n, and then we have B. And if you check the length, that turns out to be 3. So that's good. We know how to check the length of a string. If you want to actually take the string and then convert it into a list. So a list is a different data type that we will see soon. If you want to convert it into a list, you can just pass it into the list function. And now that gives you a list of all the characters, all treated separately. If you want to access individual characters in a string, you can do that as well. So today I have set to Saturday, and the way to access characters is to type the name of the variable and then type a square bracket, and inside the square bracket use an index. So the characters are indexed from 0 to n minus 1, where n is the length of the string. So you have 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, or I think this goes up to 7. So 0 is S, today 3 is 0, 1, 2, 3, U, and then today 7 is the last character. Then you can also access a part of the string by providing a start index and an end index. So for instance, we are saying 5 to 8 here. So we go from 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So that's D, 6, 7. And then the last index is actually not taken. So we do not use the last index. So we go from 5, 6, 7 and skip 8. That's just how ranges work in Python. That's how you get something out of a string. You can also check whether something is in a string. You can check whether a string contains something using the in operator. We can check day in today, that's true. We can check sun in today, that's false because today is, it says Saturday. So that's how you check whether a string contains a piece of text or not. Then you can join strings or concatenate them using the plus operator. So for instance, here we have a full name, Derek O'Brien, and then we have a greeting. So if you do greeting plus full name, then these two strings will get joined. And this is a very common thing we do. We spend a lot of time working with strings in Python and combining strings to format different messages. Now, one common thing that you might miss is that if you forget to give a space, because Derek O'Brien ends with an N and then here it starts with a hello. So if you just use a plus symbol, then here you might run into issues where this becomes a single long word called hello Derek. And you probably don't want that. So that's why what you want to do is you want to have a string here in between, which is a space. Then you have the full name. And then if you want to add something at the end, you might do that as well. So you can add many strings together. Strings in Python have many built-in methods, and these methods can be used to manipulate these strings. So we've looked at certain functions. So there's something called the print function, and then we looked at functions associated with data types. So similar to functions, there are these methods which are also functions, but they are associated with specific data types, and they are accessed using the dot notation. So any methods that are associated with strings can be accessed by taking the variable name of the string or taking an actual string and then using a dot and then calling the method. So in some sense, what this does is that lower is no longer a function that is globally defined. Only certain data types have the lower method. In fact, only strings have the lower method. So on strings, you can call the lower method by calling today.lower. And this lower method automatically gets access to the string that you are calling it on. So it has access to the value of today and it performs a certain operation. And in a lot of cases, it can return a certain result. So for instance, when we do today.lower, what happens is today was Saturday with a capital S, that becomes Saturday with a lowercase s. So we looked at the lowercase method, which takes the string and converts it into lowercase. Then we have an uppercase method. So we do Saturday.upper, and that takes a string and converts it into uppercase. And then there is another function called capitalize. This takes Monday and returns this. These are pretty simple methods, but there are also some really powerful methods that we use all the time. So one is the replace method. In the replace method, what we're going to say is we're going to take Saturday, the string, and then we're going to call replace and then give it a couple of inputs. So we want to give it the input. What do we want to replace? So let's say we want to replace Saturday, and what do we want to replace it with? So let's say we want to replace it with Wednesday, and that makes Saturday Wednesday, right? So this is something that you might do from time to time within a string. But do note that any string methods, and this is unique to strings, any string methods will always return a new string. They will not modify the original string. So for instance, even though another day has the value Wednesday, and today still has the value Saturday. And this is a key thing to watch out, whether methods modify the existing object or they return a new object. And we'll see with lists how that is different. Another one is a split method. I will let you check this out. The split method is pretty useful. There is one more called the strip method. The strip method can remove spaces from the beginning and the end of a string, not from the middle. That is also pretty useful. It can remove white space characters. It can remove new line characters. So these two are pretty useful when we are reading in data from a file. And we will see that over time. Then one very useful method is the format method. And the format method is used to combine the values of other data types with strings. Let's look at an example here. So here we have a few variables. We have the cost of an ice bag, and then we have a profit margin, and then we have a number of bags. As such, they are just three variables that we have initialized, and they have different data types. And then we want to output a certain message. We want to say that if a grocery store sells ice bags at a certain rate per bag with a profit margin of a certain percent, then the total profit it makes by selling a certain number of ice bags is such and such. Let's say we want to do this for many different combinations of price, profit margin, and number of bags. What you can do is you can create the string and you can leave out gaps. So wherever you want to fill in a value later on, you can simply put in these braces, and you can see that we have created a string, and the string has a bunch of braces inside it. And now what we can do is on this string, which we have called output template, on the string, we invoke the format method. What I've done here is, first I have done some calculation. So I have multiplied the cost of the ice bag, which is some commodity we are selling, with the profit margin, with the number of bags, and that gives us a total profit. Now, with the total profit, we want to insert all of these numbers. So these three variables and the total profit, we want to insert it into the output template. So we say output template dot format. And then after saying dot format, we give a list of variables. So these can be variables. These can actually be some expressions. So for instance, here I'm multiplying the profit margin, which is 0.2, by 100 to convert it into a percentage. And then the number of bags and the total profit. And then what happens is when you use the format method, that gives a new string back. And that new string has the variable values inserted inside it. So now you can see it says the grocery store sells a bag at $1.25 per bag, with a such and such profit margin, and by selling 500 ice packs, the total profit is $125. So this is something that we will use all the time. Do get used to the format method. Just play around with it. Instead of formatting, you can also use the string concatenation operator to achieve this. But you might get issues when you're trying to concatenate or you're trying to add strings with numbers or other data types. And the way to actually solve for that is to take each of these variables which you are doing concatenation with and convert them into a string using the str function. So you see here we get an error here, but here we can use the str function. But the key idea here is that strings have methods. You can call these methods, you can give them some inputs, and often these methods return new results. So as you experiment with these notebooks, try out these string methods and then try out some other string methods as well. Just like other data types, you have the str function, which can take any data type and convert it into a string. Another minor thing is that you can actually compare strings. So here I have declared a string. So you see the single equal to here. This is an assignment operator. So I've declared a string first name with the value John. And then I can compare the first name with another string using the double equal to operator. So the comparison results false with Doe, and the comparison returns true with John. So we have the equality operator, and then we also have the not equal operator, which is, in our case, first name not equal to Jane, which returns true. That's it about strings. So let's move on to lists. A list in Python is what you can probably tell. It's an ordered collection of values, and lists can hold values of different data types within them. So you may be familiar with arrays or lists in other languages like C or C++. If you're not, that's fine. But if you are, then you might know that sometimes these lists can only contain a specific type of value. But in Python, there is no such requirement. Lists can contain different types of values as well. So this is how we create a list. So I'm saying fruits equals apple, banana, and cherry. That is a list. And if you check the type of fruits, you will get back the list as the type. Now, here is another list. This has a bunch of different kinds of values. It has a number, it has a string, it has the none object, it has 3.14, the value of pi, it has fruits, another list as an element or a member of the list, and it has an expression which resolves to true. So that's nice that list can contain all of these different things. And then a list can also be empty. And to create an empty list, you just open these brackets with nothing. So to create a list, you need to open a square bracket and close a square bracket. Now, just like strings, you can check how many elements there are in a list using the len function. So the fruits had three members, and you can also then take that and use that in string messages using the print function or using the string formatting function and so on. So the other list had six members, and then the other list had zero. That's how you check the length of a list. Then if you want to access an element that is present inside a list, you need to use the list indexing notation, which basically means the variable name followed by a square bracket followed by an index. So in Python, numbers are elements are indexed from zero. So now you have the zeroth element, the first element, and the second element. So I like to say zeroth element because that makes it easier for me to type these things out. You might call apple the first element, but if you start thinking of it or just mentally calling it the zeroth element, you will make fewer mistakes while accessing specific elements from lists. So here's the zeroth element, and here's the first one, and here's the second. One interesting thing about lists is that you can put in any number here, and if you put in a number that is larger than the size of the list or even equal to, because the size of the list is 3, but the only valid indices are 0, 1, and 2. So if you put in a value that is bigger, then Python will give you an index error. And you might expect that if you want to access a list and you're accessing a value that does not exist, you get an error. But if you put in a negative value, so specifically if you put in -1, then this is what you get back. You get back cherry, which seems to be the last element of the list. So lists also support negative indexing. And when you're doing negative indexing, it starts from the end. So here is this is -1, this is -2, and this is -3. And this is a very useful way when you don't know the length of the list, you still want to access the last element. So you can just put in -1 and get the element back. So that's something that you can try out. But again, if you go too far negative, you're going to get an error. Another thing that you can do is you can also access a whole range of values within a list. So for instance, here I have a list, and then this has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 elements. You can see here it has 6 elements, and one of the elements itself is another list. And now if I want to access the second element to the fifth element, I can simply put in 2:5, and that's going to give me a sublist of the list. So the result is also going to be a list. So let's just guess what the answer might look like. So we have the zeroth element, we have the first element, and then we have the second element. So it starts at this. So you will get back none. This is the third element, 3.14. You will get back this. This is the fourth element, apple, banana, cherry, the fruits list. We should get back this as well. And then this is the fifth element. But here's the key thing. Ranges in Python end one step before the last element that is given. So when you say 2 to 5, that actually means the indices 2, 3, and 4 only, not 5. And that is why you get back a list containing the three elements, none, 3.14, and the fruits list. You can play around with ranges. There are a few exercises that you should try out. Try setting indices to a range that is higher or lower than the size of the list, like 2 to 10 or 2 to 5 or 2 to 7. Just see what happens. Try leaving out the start index or the end index and see what happens. It works. Can you figure out what it does? Try using ranges with negative indices. So I have left a few blank code cells for you to try this out. Just accessing lists, there are a lot of different powerful ways to do it, and ranges is probably one of the easiest ways that you should get a hang of. So now we've looked at what lists are. We have looked at how to check the length of a list, how to get elements out of a list. But what you can also do is you can modify the list. So lists in Python can be modified. And the way to do it is if you want to change the element at a particular index, you simply access that index and then use the assignment operator to put in the element. So what that does is now banana gets changed to blueberry. So that's good. Now we are modifying a list. Another way to modify a list is to add something at the end. And to add something at the end, we use the append method. So we use the append method here. Another thing that you can do is you can insert an element at a specific index. This is the zeroth position, so this is going to be the first position. So just before this element, something is going to get inserted. So you can see here that banana got inserted before blueberry. And then you can remove a particular element from a list as well. So just try remove as well. And then there is another method called pop. So remove takes a value and removes that value from the list. And then pop takes an index and removes the value at that index. I'll let you try those out. I'll leave those as exercises for you. Then similar to strings, you can check whether a certain element is a part of a list or not. So if we check pineapple in fruits, here's a fruits list. So if we check pineapple in fruits, we get back false. But if we check cherry in fruits, we get back true because cherry is in fact part of the list. Now note that you have to put in the entire element exactly to match. So if you put in just cherries or if you just put in CHER share, that is not going to work. So the element has to match exactly and then you will get back a true result. So that's how you check if something is part of a list. And then to combine two or more lists, again, pretty straightforward. You simply take a list and then you say fruits and then you use a plus symbol and then you put in another list and then you put in one more if you want to. You can concatenate or combine any number of lists. We have the combined list now. There are also certain methods that you can use on lists. So for instance, there is a copy method that is used to create a copy of a list. And then there is a remove method. And then there is a pop method. These are things that we have seen. So you can try out more of these methods. And I've provided a link here. And try to use these methods to answer these questions. Reversing the elements of a list is one. Adding elements from one list at the end of another list, sorting a list of strings in alphabetical order, and sorting a list of numbers in decreasing order. So just see if you can check out these references and you can do these exercises. And if you cannot, then a good place to discuss or post where you are getting stuck would be the lecture forum thread. There's a lot of activity going on there. So just post your question and somebody will answer your question. Now, similar to lists, there is another data structure called tuple. And the difference between lists and tuples is that tuples are immutable, which means they cannot be modified once they have been created. Here I'm creating a tuple, and the way to create a tuple is instead of a square bracket, you simply use a round bracket, parentheses. And they support many similar operations, like you can check the length is 3, you can check an element with a positive index, with a negative index, you can check if a fruit contains an element, so the dates is a part of fruits. But what happens if you try to change an element? So if I try to set fruits 0 to avocado, that is going to give you an error. And you cannot append to a tuple and you cannot remove elements from a tuple. Okay, so that's one of the key differences. So we use tuples when we want to make sure that a list of elements cannot get modified. And we use lists when we can allow modifications, when we want some flexibility. So that's about tuples. And then there is a little more that you can explore here about tuples. And you can convert tuples to lists and lists to tuples and back and forth. There is no difference here. And just like lists, tuples have some methods as well, but a fairly limited number of methods. And finally, I want to talk about dictionaries. A dictionary is an unordered collection of values. So there is no specific order to the values stored in a dictionary. Now, if you do not have order, how do you access these values? So what dictionaries have is that apart from values that you put into the dictionary, they also have keys. In a sense, it is a lookup table. So this is how you create a dictionary. You open a curly bracket or a brace, it's called, and then you close a brace. And between the brace, you create key value pairs. Typically, keys are strings. So you have a key here, and then that key points to a certain value. And the value can be of any data type. The key name points to the value John Doe, and the key sex points to the value male, and the key age points to the value 32, and the key married points to true. So this is a much nicer way of storing information, let's say, about a person, rather than just putting all the values in a list, because then you would have to remember what the first element represents and what the second element represents and so on. But here we have encoded it into the dictionary itself. So I've created a dictionary here, and now if I do person 1, you can see that all these keys and values are present in the dictionary. And then there's another way to create the dictionary using the dict function, which has more of a function invocation syntax, but it does the same thing. So here you can see that just like person 1, we have created a person 2 with a different name, sex, age, and married keys. But the type of each of these is a dict. So there you go. Now, when you want to access a value from a dictionary, you do it by providing the key. So you need to know what keys you want to access. If I want to access the name of person one, I use the same indexing notation, which is the square bracket, and then I simply put in the key. So here I put in the key name, and when I run it, I get back John Doe. Similarly, when you do person one married, you get back true, and then person two name, you are getting back Jane Judy. And if a key isn't present in the dictionary, you get a key error. Okay. Now, if you want to avoid a key error, you can use the get method. So again, from person two, if I try to get the address key, which does not exist, I can use a get method and I can provide a default value that can be returned if the dictionary does not contain that key. You can check whether a key is present in the dictionary. So this is checking keys, not values. So whether a key is present in the dictionary using the in operator. So name exists in person one, but address does not exist in person one. So that's how you get values out of a dictionary. Then next, you can also change the values associated with a key using the assignment operator. So here I'm using the assignment operator to set married for person two from false to true. And the assignment operator can also be used to just add new key value pairs. So person one does not have an address. They have a name, sex, age, and married. But if I set person one's address to 1 Penny Lane, now you can see that the address shows up here as well. And then dictionaries have certain methods. So dictionaries provide methods to access just the keys using dictionary.keys and access just the values or access the entire key value pairs. And then there are many other methods that dictionaries provide, which you can try out. And we will use many of these in the future. So here are some experiments that you should try out with dictionaries. So what happens if you use the same key multiple times? How do you create a copy of a dictionary? How can you change the value associated with a key? Can you change it to be a dictionary itself? Can you have this kind of a hierarchical structure? And there are a couple more experiments. So do try these out. Again, I've left you some blank spaces to try these out. And then I've also linked to the Python documentation and then certain other tutorials where you can learn more about data types in Python. So with that, the last thing that we should do, since our notebook is running on an online platform, is we should import the Jovian library and then run jovian.commit with a project name. So I'm going to set my project name to variables live and this just running jovian.commit. And now that is going to ask me for an API key, which I can get from my profile. So I just copy the API key. So once I'm logged into jovian.ml, I copy the API key and paste it back here. And what that does is that takes the notebook that we were just looking at and it captures a snapshot of that notebook and then it puts it onto your jovian.ml profile. So now we can close this and then this is then now going to go away, this binder instance. But my Jupyter notebook is here for me to view whenever I need to. And I can go back and I can run it using the run button. So that's what we do. We run these notebooks on Binder. We make some changes. We bring them back. We bring them back on Jovian and then we keep making changes. And that's how we start collecting different versions of the notebook. So all the updates that you make over time get recorded. So with that, we've completed our discussion of variables and data types. Let us move on to the next topic, which is branching and loops.